You're listening to the audio production of Parenting, Getting It Right by Andy and Sandra Stanley, published by Zondervan and read by the authors.
Acknowledgements. The names on a book jacket would never get there without a team of people working behind the scenes to ensure there is a book and a book jacket to begin with. This book is certainly no exception. An enormous thank you to Jessica Duquette, Emily Beach, and Holly Duncan. This project was your idea. Thank you for planting the seed, gathering and organizing content, creating our initial table of contents, and even writing the first few drafts. To Susie Gray, your attention to detail and your tenacity in keeping the details in front of us got us to the finish line. To our friends at Zondervan, thank you for believing in this project. We are especially grateful for Kim Tanner. Kim, your edits, questions, and suggestions made this manuscript clearer, cleaner, and crisper. Thank you. To our amazing parents, words fall short in thanking you for life, for love, for encouragement, and for modeling the kind of parents we strove to be. To Andrew, Garrett, and Allie, along with Anna, Danielle, and Clay, wow, what an honor to be your parents and parents-in-law. Thanks for your patience with us where we got it wrong and your kindness in letting us know where we got it right. And to our gracious Heavenly Father, the only perfect parent, how grateful we are to be your children.
Introduction. It makes all the difference. When Sandra was a senior in high school, she underwent significant back surgery. The results were twofold. She went into surgery at 5'7", and she came out at 5'9", thus ending her dreams of a spot on the American Olympic gymnastics team. The second outcome was that because of some added hardware, Sandra's surgeon recommended she opt for a C-section if she became pregnant. From an expectant mom's perspective, a C-section has a couple of advantages, most notably that the mom gets to schedule the delivery so there is less fear of her water breaking at Walmart in aisle 9 while her husband is golfing in a remote location with no cell service. From an expectant father's perspective, the biggest advantage is not having to attend childbirthing classes, or so I thought. We'd been married 4 years when the parallel pink lines changed our lives forever. By that time, I knew I had married a rule follower, and I'd come to appreciate her by-the-book approach to life. But I was still surprised when Sandra informed me she had signed us up for 4 2-hour birthing classes. I say surprised. Dismayed would be more accurate. Why spend 4 Tuesday nights learning about something I didn't want to know more about and didn't need to know anyway? I mean, technically, she wasn't going to give birth. She was going to have surgery. No, I did not say that out loud. Anyway, 3 weeks later, Sandra and I were sitting on a blanket on the tile floor of a Sunday school classroom at our church, surrounded by pillows, tennis balls, and a dozen or so other expectant couples. We practiced breathing and pushing exercises. I dutifully memorized my coaching encouragement script all the time, thinking, I'm pretty sure the anesthesiologist will ensure none of this is necessary. But when all was said and done, I was glad we attended the birthing classes. As it turned out, the breathing exercises did come in handy, but for me. I didn't know it at the time, but just as fathers are encouraged to be in the delivery room for a traditional delivery, they're encouraged to be in the operating room for a C-section. The only time Dr. Lyons looked concerned during Sandra's C-section was when he thought I might pass out. One additional advantage to a C-section is that the mamas generally get to enjoy an additional night of pampering in the hospital. That was nice. But all good things must come to an end. My good thing ended when I heard the nurse say, Mr. Stanley, if you'll pull your car around to the main entrance, we will bring Mrs. Stanley and baby Andrew down to meet you. I employed my recently acquired breathing exercises in that moment. They were making us leave? But why? Other than the food, everything was perfect here. So why leave now and why go home? Nobody in our house had any experience taking care of a baby. Surely they would not let us take a baby home all by ourselves. But they did. They always do. As we drove away, the nurse waved goodbye with a knowing look that said, you have no idea. And she was correct. But we figured it out, and so did you. By figured it out, I mean we figured out how to feed, clothe, change, and burp a baby, and eventually get him to sleep through the night. But even with all that ostensible success, there was always this disquieting question. Are we doing it right? If your child is more than 5 years old, I don't have to tell you that that initial concern never completely goes away. It's why you're reading a book about parenting. You're pretty sure you're doing it right, but when it comes to our kids, we don't want to be pretty sure. We want to be sure. If there's one area of life we have to get right, it's this one. So the question is always there, hovering in the background. Then, just when we feel like we might be doing it right, the seasons change. They outgrow their shoes and their beds, and we wonder sometimes if maybe they're outgrowing us. Eventually, hormones flip the script. The question that hovered in the background for the first 11 or 12 years is suddenly front and center. We no longer have the luxury of assuming we're doing it right. There are daily reminders that more than likely we're not. And our kids assure us that we're doing it wrong because their best friend's parents are clearly doing it right. And of course, their best friends assure their parents that they're doing it wrong as well. So, are you doing it right? It's a terrifying question. It's terrifying because while life comes equipped with a rearview mirror, life doesn't come equipped with reverse. We can look back and we can see what we should have done differently, but we can't back up and do it all again. Our mistakes are a permanent part of our parenting story, but worse, our mistakes are a permanent part of our children's childhood. Just to encourage you, our three kids are all married now, but Sandra and I still wonder at times if we're doing it right. While working on the manuscript for this book, we've been in a weekly discussion group with five other couples on the topic of parenting adult children. You probably didn't know that was a thing. Well, it is. One day, you will be parenting adults. So no, parenting doesn't end once they leave the house. Their moving out is just a segue to another season. While the concerns change from season to season, there will always be something to be concerned about. And there is always the concern of doing it wrong. But back to it. What is it? What exactly is the it we want to get right as parents? What is the it we so desperately don't want to get wrong? Why are you reading a book or perhaps another book on parenting? Clearly, you want to get something right. But what? What is the it? Our observation is that most parents are so busy parenting, they never stop to consider what they're parenting to, what they're parenting for. They're too busy to stop and consider the end game, the goal, the prize, the win. And I'm not being critical. We get it. We had three in diapers for a minute. More on that later. So what is it? What is the win for you as a parent? You have one. Every parent has one. In two-parent homes, it's not uncommon for parents to have different wins in mind. And when that's the case, they parent at cross purposes. The result is a tension that neither parent can explain, but one that children sense and teenagers often exploit. So, what is your it? What's the win? Is it safety? Obedience? Graduation? To make you proud? To get into the NFL? Broadway, for your kids to have the things you never had, to go further educationally than you had the opportunity to go. I coached enough baseball to know that for some, the win is for kids to excel where their parents hoped to, but didn't. And by the way, none of those goals are bad or wrong, but when culled and examined, none of those goals are enough. And that's the problem. So allow me to be direct. Granted, it's a bit early in our relationship for that, but indulge me anyway. If you don't hit pause long enough to consider the direction in which you are parenting, you may wake up one day to the realization that you parented in the wrong direction. By wrong, I mean you parented in a direction you would not have chosen had you stopped long enough to choose. This happens all the time. It happens all the time in multiple areas of life. Think about it. Everybody ends up somewhere in life. The folks who decide on a direction ahead of time usually end up somewhere on purpose. It's the principle of the path, that our direction determines our destination. This is also true for parenting. We parent in a direction. The direction we choose, consciously or unconsciously, will in some ways determine our children's destination. The direction we choose for our parenting has the potential to affect our kids emotionally, relationally, and spiritually, as well as academically and professionally. Sandra and I are foster parents. We've seen this principle play out in the worst imaginable ways. By the time children are removed from their homes and placed in foster care, the parents' influence on the trajectory of their children's lives is heartbreaking and frightening. You are parenting your children in a direction. You owe it to them to choose that direction ahead of time. Not convinced? Consider this. If you don't define and choose your it, it will be chosen for you. If your parenting style, and by that I mean your habits, your responses, your approach to discipline, if your parenting style is not dictated by a predetermined win, it will be dictated by circumstances, culture, and the reactions of your children and the expectations of others, including your parents and in-laws. When that happens, parenting becomes a whirlwind. In the whirlwind, parenting is reduced to reacting rather than leading, reacting to the immediate instigation rather than leading toward a predetermined destination. Parenting is complicated. You want to get it right. To do that, you have to determine your it. And that's what this book is about. Sort of. Actually, Sandra and I would like to suggest an it. The it we're convinced makes all the difference. It's not original with us. We borrowed it from veteran parents we've observed and done life with through the years, parents who we feel like got it right. In that regard, we had two advantages. First, we spent 10 years working with middle school and high school students at a local church. For 10 years, we had a behind-the-curtain look at a variety of family systems and a broad range of parenting styles. I think we saw them all. Permissive, legalistic, fear-based, helicopter, too involved, not involved enough. We watched parents bail their kids out of situations the kids got themselves into, and we saw parents shrug as if to say, sucks to be you. We took a lot of notes, and we initiated dozens of lunch and dinner conversations with parents who seemed to be doing it right. That process began 30 years ago, before we even had children of our own. Many of the students who were involved in our ministry are still involved with our churches. They're now married with kids of their own, and several students from our youth ministry are already grandparents. That's three generations we've had the privilege to watch, evaluate, and learn from. And the parents who got it right all had something in common. They shared the same North Star. They parented for the same win. The second advantage that we had was Sandra's parents. They certainly got it right. What I saw in them confirmed the core value we observed in the church families we admired the most. That core value defined our it, and we will begin unpacking it in chapter one. But first this, Sandra and I don't assume to speak with any authority to single parents or blended families. We both grew up in two-parent homes, but it may help you to know that both of our fathers were parented by single moms. Sandra's grandfather died when her father was 12. My grandfather died before my father turned 2. They both lost the influence of their fathers, but both of our fathers served as excellent role models for their children. They prioritized the same it, and it worked. Again, we know parenting is complicated. You want to get it right. We think we can help. So in the chapters that follow, we will tell you everything we know about parenting. Not everything there is to know, just what we know. Or to put it another way, we don't assume we can fill your parenting cup, but we are about to empty ours. Here we go. Chapter 1, Our North Star. So I'm not much of a goal setter, but my dad is. And when I was 13, he sat me down at his desk at home with a pen and a pad and instructed me to set some goals for my life. Again, I was 13. Then he left the room. He returned about 30 minutes later to a picture of airplanes bombing tanks, but, well, no goals. We were both frustrated. He was concerned I would meander through life, and I was afraid I would set the wrong goals. Or worse, I would set the right goals and then fail to accomplish them. Either way, at 13, I thought it seemed prudent not to set any to begin with. So I didn't, until Andrew was born. Here's what happened. Sandra and I were in the middle of a six-hour drive with infant Andrew strapped into his car seat. We were on our way to meet her parents and siblings for a week at the beach on Hilton Head Island. For reasons I honestly can't remember, we decided to set some family goals. Now, if a week in one house with members of your extended family is not your dream vacation, I get it. Some families can't spend a weekend together without something going awry, but not with the Walkers. Early in our relationship, I noticed that Sandra's family genuinely liked spending time together. Sandra and her two siblings didn't mind driving 2+ hours to see their parents and their grandparents. Sandra's brother lived in California for several years, and when the family gathered without him, they always called Jack to tease him about what he was missing out on, usually some home cooking and grandmama's cookies. What was just another day in the neighborhood for the Walker family was new, unusual, and attractive to me. The Walker family was, well, they were drama-free, tension-free. It was relaxed, enjoyable. On our way to the coast, I brought this up with Sandra. It wasn't the first time. And as was the case every time I talked with Sandra about her unusual family dynamic, She simply nodded as if to say, "So, what's your point?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.